Okay.
And so if everything is ready, so good afternoon again. And before starting, I would like to thank you all for your presence here. Today it's a great honor and pleasure for me to introduce the distinguished lecture given by Professor Pedro Gebelin from the West University of Timișoara. The research activity of Professor Gebelin is remarkable, and his studies in ordinary and partial differential equations attract a great interest, also because he always proposes an original use of refined techniques of nonlinear analysis and a nice combination of topological and variational methods. In particular, among the others, he is a great expert on differential problems involving the mean curvature operator. He was invited as a keynote speaker at various mathematics congresses, and he also received many awards, among them the Prize Professor Bologna of the National Alliance of Student Organizations in Romania, the Prize Simeon Stoilo of the Romanian Academy, the Prize Traian Lalescu for Mathematics and Natural Sciences, as well as the Prize Mihail Germanescu for mathematics and informatics. Today, Professor Gebelin will speak up about the periodic critical orbits for the relativistic operator. Please, Professor.
Thank you, Roberto, for the very generous presentation. I also would like to thank the organizer for this opportunity to give a talk in this very interesting webinar on nonlinear differential problems. As already said, the title of my talk is Periodic Critical Orbits for the Relativistic Operator. And this talk is based on joint work with Jean Mauen and Karine Sherban. This is the outline of my lecture. We shall begin with some classics. Then we give our main result together with its proof. We'll discuss also the discontinuous case where as application we shall concern on Filipov solutions. The talk will be concluded with some further remarks. Okay, let us begin. First, I would like to recall that the relativistic operator, here defined, U maps to phi of U prime prime, or where phi is this strongly monotone operator from the open unit ball in Rn to Rn. We'll be concerned with the existence of multiple geometrically distinct solutions, the systems of type 1 here, where H, the forcing term, is an N1 function, while the potential capital F will be a Cara-Teodori function, which is of class U1 with respect to the second variable. Now, in recent years, various results on the existence and multiplicity of periodic solutions for nonlinear perturbations of the relativistic operator were obtained. Here we listed in chronological order only some landmark works, and concerning the approaches, we note that topological arguments, here we mean fixed points, Le Ray, Schauder degree, extensions of the Poincaré-Birkhoff theorem, were employed by Mauen, Fonda, Maro, Torres, Ureña, Beriano, Tader, while variational inequalities and critical point techniques for smooth or non-smooth functionals, direct or reducing to Hamiltonian systems were used in the approaches of Bresisma when Manasevich, Ward, Ambrosetti, Arcoia, Berano, Sherban, and of course, this list is far from being complete. Let us first refer to some classics. Here, classics has two meanings. The first is that the acceleration will be the classical one, meaning U prime prime. And also the second meaning is that all the results we shall refer here are already classic in the literature. If we begin with this simple problem two here, with G, a continuous 2π periodic function with a note by capital G, it's primitive, and consider this second order differential equations with periodic boundary conditions. Solutions of problem two are precisely critical points of the energy functional defined here in three. It is defined on the Sobolev space H1t, meaning the functions from H1, which are periodic at the end of the interval 0t. If these two conditions in 4 hold true, meaning this integral vanish and this mean vanish too, then E achieves its infimum on H1t and consequently problem 2 is solvable. This result was independently proved by Willem and Danser in 81 and 82 using the frame of the Sobolev spaces, while actually they discovered earlier result due to Hamel since 1922 in the frame of obtained in the frame of 2π periodic C1 functions. Now let us observe that if U is a solution of problem 2 due to the periodicity of G, also U plus 2kπ solves problem 2 for any k in Z. We say that U and U plus 2kπ are geometrically the same. When two solutions does not differ by a multiple of 2kπ, then we see tell that they are geometrically distinct. Okay. Now, actually, under assumption 4, when we saw that the problem 2 is solvable, under assumption 4, problem 2 has a second geometrically distinct solution. This result was obtained by Mouen and Willem in 1984 by means of a variational argument. Also a variational argument, but as a consequence of their variant of mountain pass theorem was provided by Pucci and Serin in 84 and 85. A different proof was given by Franks, and this proof of Franks relies on a generalized version of the Poincaré-Birkhoff theorem. Okay, so we have a second geometrically distinct solution for the one-dimensional periodic problem two. If you want to pass the systems, then we have to make some remarks. Since we have the equivalence, G is 2 pi periodic and this integral vanish is equivalent with the primitive capital G is 2 pi periodic, it follows that 2 has two geometrically distinct solutions provided that capital G is 2 pi periodic and the forcing term has null mean. Okay, how does it look a system? It must be precise. Here we deal with potential systems. It looks like here in 6, where the potential G, capital G, is assumed to satisfy condition 1C and 2C. G is a Carathéodory function, which is continuously differentiable with respect to X, has its gradient bounded by an L1 function and the integral of E vanish. This is the first condition on G and also on E. The second one says that G of T x1 to xn is omega I periodic with respect to each component xi from 1 to n. Under assumption 1c and 2c, system 6 has at least n plus 1 geometrically distinct solutions. This is the extension, the result of the result in the one-dimensional case to the system. And it was obtained independently by Rabinowitz, Chang, and Mauen, published in the was independently obtained in 87, published very close in 88, 89. Now, here we have assumed that capital G is periodic with respect to all the X components. What happens if we have the periodicity only with respect to a part of this variables. Namely, we replace condition 2c by 2c prime. G is omega I periodic with respect to each xi for all I from 1 to some n less than capital N. Under assumption 1c as before and 2c prime, system 6 with E identical zero, has at least n plus one geometrically distinct solution, provided that the potential capital G is partially uniformly coercive in the meaning of formula 7 here. We have this converges to plus infinity uniformly in Tx1 till Xm as the n plus one till xn set of components tends to infinity in Rn minus m. This was proved by Chang and Liu with different techniques. Actually, Liu introduced a generalization of the saddle point theorem, and this will be used also in the next discussion, in the discussion following, namely, the partially uniformly coerciveness condition can be replaced, so this one can be replaced by the partially semi-coerciveness condition, meaning that instead of this convergence, we have the convergence of this integral uniformly in x1 to xm as this component tends to infinity. Okay, I wrote here or minus infinite because this is still true. So if we have semi-coerciveness or semi-anti-coerciveness, the same conclusion holds true. And this was proved by Tang and Wu in 2004. Actually, with even a weaker condition, but essentially this is important in our discussion. Okay, now it is a natural way to follow these results for the classical acceleration in the case of the relativistic one. Namely, we consider this problem nine, where H in L1 and capital F satisfy the following hypothesis. First, on H, the hypothesis is for a positive integer M less than N, one has that these components have null mean. And secondly, capital F, the potential, satisfy one and two means that actually that the capital F is a Cara-Teodori function, which is of class E1, which respect to the second variable. And also we assume that F of zero is zero. And now these are the main hypothesis. First, the gradient of capital F is bounded by an L1 function. Capital F is omega I periodic with respect to each xi, I from 1 to m, m less than n. And the potential of the right hand member of the equation satisfies this semi-anticoerciveness condition. Of course, it is natural to ask what about the semi-coerciveness, not semi-anti-semic. So the semi-coerciveness, not as here, semi-anticoerciveness. We'll discuss this in the next. First, by a solution of 9, we mean a function u of class c1 with the norm of the derivative less than 1, phi of u prime is absolutely continuous, which satisfies this n-dimensional system and the boundary conditions. From this hf4 concerning the omega I periodicity with respect to the first component, we infer that if u is a solution of 9, then u hat equal to u plus sum from I equal to 1 to m, ki omega I ei, e here ei is the canonical basis in Rn, with sum k1 to km in z, then also u hat is solves problem 9. Yeah. In this view, two solutions, u and u hat of 9, are said to be geometrically distinct if for any k1 to km in z, one has that their difference differ from some for a combination of omega I ei with weights, with integer weights, actually. Yeah. And now this, let us be concrete. These are the hypotheses for our main results. Now a little discussion. Why just this one? First, in the case m equal to n, of course, with HF5 dropped, problem 9 has at least n plus 1 geometrically distinct solutions. And this was proved by Jean Mouen in 2012 by reducing the problem to a Hamiltonian system and applying generalized saddle point theorem DOT Zulkin for indefinite functionals. Is technically is a technique proof, and it was stated showing actually that what we know about the system in the classical case remained true in the relativistic case. Together with Berianu, we have tried to give an alternative, simpler proof of the result of Mawen. We succeeded to do this, but the proof is only alternative, is not simpler. It relies on developing machinery using the Lichtenstein-Schneiderman category, and so till the end is only alternative. But a simpler indeed proof in the case of this relativistic operator we obtained together with Mawen and Sherban in 2015 by reducing the system which is with singular differential operator to a system which is with a non-singular differential operator and making use of the classical critical point theory. The proof is simpler but not elementary. Okay, now let us come back to the case M less than capital N. The complementary case, complementary to our hypothesis here, actually was solved by Hata, Liu, and Wang in 2013 under the hypothesis that H is an L2 function having the first M components with null mean. F of Tx is 2 pi periodic in x1 to xm, and the gradient with respect to x is bounded. And writing x as the couple yz with y in Rm and z in Rn minus m, it holds that this limit is plus infinite, uniformly in y in Rn. Y is the first component of X here. Namely, they prove that under assumptions HF 1, 2, this is the general assumption concerning the Kara-Teodoro function, and A, B, C, problem 9 has at least M plus 1 geometrically distinct solution. And their proof relies on the saddle point generalization of the saddle point theorem DOT Liu. And now it becomes natural, what about the complementary condition when we here have minus infinity? So in such way, we arrived to our set of hypotheses. Because this complementary condition, if it holds true, then it is stronger than our hypothesis HF5. Well, the result which we obtained in 2020 is the following, theorem A. This is the main result, actually, of this lecture. Under assumption HH and HF, problem 9 has at least M plus 1 geometrically distinct solutions. And so the same things happen as in the classical case. Before giving the proof, I choose here to give an example for E in L1, having the mean between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, the two-dimensional system here which is periodic and two-dimensional, has at least two geometrically distinct solutions. And to see this, our theorem A here applies with this choice of H, zero E here. And the potential F, capital F of Tx1, x2, like here, we see this is periodic only with respect to x1, not x2. That's why we have only two geometrically distinct solutions. Now, good. Now to prove the theorem, this theorem, we shall reduce the problem to a non-singular system. How can we do this? As follows. Setting K as being phi at minus one of this closed ball centered at the origin and having this radius, which is a subset of the open ball of center zero and radius one in Rn, we set, so this is K. Clearly, this is a compact set in this open ball. We fix capital R closed enough to one. It is between zero, one, but it will be closed enough to one, such that this inequality holds true and this inclusion holds true. Summarizing, we have K here and we fix R such that these two conditions be fulfilled. And by means of this capital R, we define the homeomorphism psi as here. It has a little bit complicated form, which has this potential capital psi. I will show you how this is constructed. Psi, we first have this original singular phi. You see, it comes asymptotically to these lines. And we cut the graph of phi with a line such that R is close enough to one here. And between minus R and R, we keep phi in the definition of psi. And outside of this interval, psi will go on the line here. In this way, psi is defined and continues on whole the Rn, actually, and it is a strongly monotone operator. Here is its potential, capital psi, which we see is strictly convex, and between minus R and R, it has a form, and outside it has another form here. I said already that psi is strongly monotone, and its potential is capital psi. Also, it is important that the capital psi has this behavior. We can say it is bounded by two quadratic forms. In the case n equal one, this means this is bounded by two parabolas. Okay, now with this psi, we consider the non-singular system 12 here, where by difference with system 9, we only have modified here. Instead of phi, we have psi. Where, of course, F and H fulfill conditions HF and HH. We can prove that a function u in C1 is solution of 9 if and only if it solves problem 12 here. And so we reduced the problem, which originally is singular to the non-singular one. And the functional framework will be the framework of the Sobolev space, H1T actually, U in H1, which are periodic, H1T tilde, the functions in H1T, which have null mean. Each U can be written as its mean plus U tilde here. These are standard. And we define the energy functional attached to problem 12 here to the non-singular problem. One has that this I is of class U1 on H1T, and this is its derivative. One can prove that if U is a critical point of I, then U is C1 and is a solution of our problem 12 here. By the way, solution of problem 9. Next, we have to make use a tool a little bit more sophisticated, namely critical orbits of a functional. This tool also is employed in the study in the classical case, but of course with easier features. Let G be a discrete subgroup of a real Banach space X, and pi from X to the quotient group X over G be the canonical projection. A function f from X to R is said to be G invariant if f of X plus G equal to f of X for all X in capital X and G in G. If f is G invariant and differentiable, then f prime is also J invariant. So if X is a critical point of such J, then we have a lot of other critical points. And these are, for a critical point X, pi at minus one from of pi of X. To see this pi of X as a subset of X. This is a set of critical points. So this set of critical points in X is called a critical orbit of F. A G invariant differentiable function is said to satisfy the Pallas-Mayle G condition if for every sequence Xn in X, such that f of xn is bounded and f prime of xn converges to zero, the sequence pi of xn contains a subsequence convergent in the quotient group x over g. And the main ingredient will be this theorem 5, which is proved in the seminal work of Mawen and Willem, critical point theory and Hamiltonian systems. It says that let F be a C1 G invariant function, satisfying the PSG condition. If F is bounded from below and the dimension D of the subspace generated by the discrete subgroup is finite, then F has at least D plus one critical orbits. This will be very useful because in the proof of theorem A, we shall apply this theorem 5 with the following choices. X will be H1T, F will be calligraphic I, and the discrete subgroup will be this one, namely some elements. Actually, this is a subgroup of Rn. sum from I equal to 1 to m of ki omega I ai, ki being from z. One has the dimension of the subspace generated by gm is m. And so we have only to, it remains only to prove that I, under these circumstances, is bounded from below and satisfies the PSG condition. First, it is easy to see that I is GM invariant. Now, in order to prove that it is bounded from below and satisfies the PSG condition, we shall proceed as follows. For each U in H1T, we shall modify its mean so that the periodicity to be involved and to keep the mean with respect to the some components to keep it to be bounded precisely. You let U be arbitrarily chosen in H1T. We said ZU P U bar plus Q U bar plus U tilde. U tilde is unchanged. Here, P U bar makes nothing else that it leaves the last N minus M components on the spot. While to define Q here, we proceed as follows. We choose the unique integer ki such that the scalar product U bar ai minus ki omega I remains in this period, in zero omega I. So qi U bar is this sum from 1 to m, and notice that these coefficients are bounded here. It is important that z u bar actually is p u bar plus q u bar. The tilde part is the same, and also the functional don't see this modification of u, namely precisely I of u equal to I of z u, and I prime of u equal to I prime of z u. It remains hidden for our function. Now, we have to estimate I of u by this inequality here. First, we argue for the boundedness of I. Clearly, this is bounded from below. If we suppose by contradiction that I is not bounded from below, then this must be on a sequence to plus infinity here. And we have to distinguish between the cases P un bar is bounded. It is immediate the contradiction here, meaning that this is bounded. Otherwise, if P of un bar is not bounded, then we invoke the hypothesis HF5, and again we obtain a contradiction. To show that I satisfy the Pallesmel-GM condition, we use this lemma, proposition actually, any sequence Vn in H1T such that I prime of Vn converges to zero and Vn is bounded in H1T contains a convergent subsequence. So we consider UN sequence such that, like in the definition of the PSG condition, I of UN is bounded, I prime of UN converges to zero. And it is easy to see that if we suppose that the norm of UN bar is not bounded, then we get a contradiction. And finally, it is bounded. And by Wittinger inequality, we obtain passing to ZUN that this is bounded in H1T. I crossed a lot, a little quickly here, but the idea is that this proposition is used with VN equal to ZUN. And we obtain that ZUN has a convergent subsequence, and then from the fact that the class of ZUN coincide with the one of UN, by the continuity of pi, we have that actually I satisfy the PSGM condition. And so this concludes the proof. Roberto, I have how much?
You have 5 minutes more.
5 minutes, okay. I will try to concentrate a little bit. The discontinuous case. In the discontinuous case, we shall consider only the situation when the potential is periodic with respect to all the components. More precisely, which is the problem? The problem is this differential inclusion. Here, instead of gradient U, we have partial U, where partial V U is the generalized Clark gradient of F of T with respect to U. Precisely, F here and H satisfies the hypothesis. One, F of dot X from 0 T to R is measurable for every X in Rn and vanish at the origin. The second condition actually replaced what in the continuous case we had saying that the gradient is bounded. Now we ask that there exists an element L alpha in L1 such that this inequality holds. Other words, this means nothing else but capital F is Lipschitz continuous with respect to the second variable. Is Lipschitz continuous to the with respect to the second variable? So it is not of class U1. Of course, when F is of class U1, this is satisfied. But the difference is this one. And as I already said, it is omega I periodic with respect to each X prime. The condition H tilde H asks that the mean of H be zero. Here I recalled what we mean by the general Clark gradient of locally Lipschitz function in our context. I'll skip because I guess the people are familiarized with these notions. By a solution with 16, we mean a function of class E1 with the norm of the derivative less than one and phi of U prime absolutely continuous, which satisfies the differential inclusion system and the boundary conditions. The main result in this section is theorem B, and we obtain in two different approaches. The first one in 2016, the second one in 2017, saying that under hypothesis, h tilde f and h tilde h, the discontinuous problem has at least n plus one geometrically distinct solutions. Here, the proof make use of the critical point theory for locally Lipschitz functionals due to Chang in 89 and an extension of theorem 5 concerning the G invariant functionals due to Mironescu and Radulescu in 1995. Of course, as expected from theorem B, we recover the continuous case here. This is expected, and this is a kind of checking if this plausibility is reasonable. Back. So I will skip to have a little bit time to refer the Filipov solution. This is only an application of the general result theorem B. Fi R function which are locally bounded on Rn. H is a function in L1. And consider this system, which is a differential inclusion system. You see here is this set, this Cartesian product, where Fi underline and Fi overline are as usual defined as lim s inf and lim s sup. Setting capital Fi, the primitive of small Fi, we have this corollary of theorem B saying that if Fi is omega I periodic for I from 1 to n and the mean of h vanish, then system 20, this one, is has at least n plus one geometrically distinct t-periodic solutions. And theorem B applies with this choice of capital F. As an example, I take here Fi of S, S minus the integer part of S minus 1 over 2, h I took to be 0. In this situation, Fi is given by this formula, and this is 1 periodic. And corollary 8 applies. Here I draw first this pulsing function Fi. You see these are jumping in each integer. And these are the multivalued function Fi underlined, Fi overlined. This is the multifunction. And also this is the primitive, the graph of the primitive. Now, these are two examples. In the case n equal to 1, this system has at least two t-periodic solutions, geometrically distinct t-periodic solutions, and in the case n equal to 2. All the results here, in a way or other way, involve the boundedness of the gradient or the sub-differential in the sense of Clark. I noted here a recent paper together with Antonia Chini, Beatrice Di Bella, and Kalin Sherban concerning periodic solution for systems with relativistic operator and unbounded discontinuous nonlinearities. Only a few remarks. Oh, the results which guided our research were the result of Mawen and Hata, Liu, and Wang. And both of them use homeomorphies, not necessarily a general homeomorphies, not necessarily the concrete one which we have discussed here, engendering the relativistic operator. And it is a natural question, what about such a general file? Of course, they ask additional condition in order to have potentiality of the problems. And partial answer is this one for a given P in one infinite. And this homeomorphism and gathering the so-called P-relativistic operator, all the result which I have discussed here remain true. It would be to say that this P-relativistic operator played the same role as the P-Laplacian play for the usual Laplacian. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Zebelin. Thank you for your very nice talk. And now, of course, if there are questions or remarks, they are welcome. So please. I don't hear. So, if not, I just the curiosity, just is, I was wondering, these kind of ideas can be in some sense revised when different boundary conditions, so no more periodic conditions can be considered in any case.
Yes, for instance, the Neumann conditions work very well. It's not the same situation for the Dirichlet or the mixed, but for the Neumann, yes.
Okay. So, if there are no other questions. I wish to thank you again, Professor, for this talk. And I also want to thank you all again for your participation here today. I recall that the next appointment of this webinar series is scheduled for April 9th with the distinguished talk by Professor Radulescu. And finally, let me wish you and your family happy Easter, and we'll hope that even if under these serious constraints, we will enjoy this as a real peaceful time. So thank you again.
Thank you.
And bye.
Goodbye.